Hey, everyone. Thank you. So Fools Fest is looking for some people to MC. And so we're going to be holding auditions/interviews. And if you are interested, you're going to just have to prepare like a 30-second spiel with maybe a joke or something. And if you're interested, just go ahead and give foolsfestloino@gmail.com an email, and we'll set up an interview. So thanks.
Hello. So the board that we have installed in the main studio is made by a company called Solid State Logic. And they have a kind of a tour demonstration vehicle that goes around the country showing off cool new stuff. So on March 7th, they will be coming here to Loyola between 12 o'clock and 2 o'clock. And so it's a pretty hip demonstration vehicle. They got the latest consoles set up. It's 5.1. They got great free coffee. I mean, it's just no way to lose. So if you're interested in checking out audio gear and want to see a portable recording studio, come out to the Palm Court between 12 and 2 March 7th. Thanks.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jack, and I play in a band called Hound. And tonight, we're playing at Gasa Gasa at 7 p.m. If you come, I'll get you water. I'll give you a pat on the back. And with a smile like mine that can't be beat, there's no reason to not come out. So thanks, everybody.
What's up, everybody? How y'all doing? How's the side doing? How y'all feeling? What's going on? Say what's up. How y'all doing? What's up? All right. And in the middle. Cool. So on the 28th of this month, I'm going to be releasing my first full-length body of work. I'm extremely excited. It's going to be called For the Time Being. And there's a couple of you guys, a couple of you talented individuals are going to be featuring on the tape. On that same day, Fat Tuesday, right after y'all go on break, mind you, I'm going to be throwing a mixtape release party at the Blue Flame Bar. The first 30 people get a personal. Wait, a personal what? The first 30 people get a personal. I'm going to just leave it at that. And we're going to be selling food as well. So, yeah. So, Fat Tuesday, the 28th. Make sure, come vibe with us. It's going to be lit. Thank you. February 28th.
Yo, what's up, everybody? For those of you that don't know me, my name is... All right, I'm going to let you guys clap, you know, for Temi. You know what I'm saying? I'm performing with Temi to support his mixtape, and it's going to be awesome. He's put a lot of work into it, so come out for sure. It's free, so, I mean, yeah. But anyways, my name is David D'Angelo, and last semester I was in New Zealand studying abroad, actually, and I got a chance to film a music video while I was out there, and I'm going to be releasing that next month, and I'm going to be... you know, just sharing a little bit more about it with you guys. I just wanted to put the word out right now before everyone, you know, does their thing over the next couple of weeks and it's all crazy and then we come back here and it's a different story. So, you know, just wanted to say that and I look forward to, you know, sharing this with you guys. Have a happy Mardi Gras. Peace.
What's up, Forum? I can't hear you. I said, what's up, Forum? Is you good? Good, because I wanted to know. I know a lot of you are looking at my shoes. Don't worry about them. They're my running shoes. But what I wanted to do today, I'm a transfer student. I haven't met a lot of you guys, so I feel like I should come introduce myself. My name is Kezra Leon, if you're nasty. And I felt like if the only way to introduce myself was to give you a gift. So, I just released a song this past weekend. How many of you know Bad and Bougie? Raise your hands. Y'all like Bad and Bougie? Mine's is better. Well, find me on SoundCloud, Instagram, Twitter, Kezra Leon. Thanks.
Hello, hello. Hi, everybody. My name is Alan Moret, and I'm here with Antoine Berry on behalf of our fraternity, Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. And we'll be holding a talent contest March 11th to raise money for the March of Dimes, which is purposed to decrease the infant mortality rate. So if you're interested, just speak to me or Antoine after this, and just email us at theroepsilonalphas@gmail.com. Thank you very much. Y'all are beautiful. See y'all in passing.
Yo, what's up, guys? My name is Wags. Thank you. I love you. So real quick, I need a little repeat after me. Y'all ready? Yeah. Thursday. Free show. Republic. Thank you.
Hey, what's up, y'all? My name is Raven. Again, y'all know me. Been up here multiple times. Just want to thank y'all for everybody who came out to NPHD Week. It was lit. excuse me. Tomorrow, I'm part of the new Mu City Y chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated. Tomorrow, we have a program called Black Mardi Gras. It's the history of the African-American community in Mardi Gras. We're not doing Mardi Gras forums, so freshmen, you don't know what that is. So I suggest a lot of freshmen come out, especially if you're not from here. You don't really know Mardi Gras, you know? So I suggest y'all come out. It's going to be lit. We're going to have a surprise guest. It's going to be lit. Maybe some king cake. You never know. Come out 7:13 tomorrow in the Audubon Room. Any more information, find me after forum. I'll be here. So have a good one, y'all.
Hello, my name is Martha. I work on campus and I'm also a student in the music business program. I want to kind of send out an invite to all music students here. I have a radio show, WHIV FM 102.3 FM, and it's Saturdays from 4 to 6. And I was thinking, I had some students two weekends ago, and it was great, how it'd be awesome to open up either the first Saturday or the last Saturday of the month to Loyola music students. Because what I did when we had music students 2 weeks ago, we kind of focused on Loyola and how awesome of a program it is in a city like New Orleans. So if you're interested, you have gigs to promote or events or whatever, just send me an email, musicsynergy504@gmail.com. Thank you.
All right. Well, you guys have been very patient. Please welcome our forum guest tonight, Eric Tobin from Hopeless Records.
Thank you. Now it's dark. I can't see anybody.
So now, yes.
Very scared.
We'll bring back the lights for question and answer. Don't worry.
Yeah, I'm very scared now.
It's looking scary. Right at it me. Is. Hi, guys. So we are very lucky. Today we have Eric Tobin with
and
us.
And his crutches.
And his crutches
My
as well.
Personality.
Supporting cast. Mm-hmm. Bing.
We're here for the dad jokes all day long. Just
Love
stick
them.
Around.
Eric, as Dr. Lowe said, has been with Hopeless Records, and he's had a really cool career that I just got the lowdown on that
Maybe.
May sound similar to what you guys are up to, and I'm excited for him to share that. But talk to us. You've been at Hopeless almost 12 years.
Almost 12 years.
Talk to us about that.
Yeah. Well, because I'm 25, I've been there since I was...
It's miraculous.
Yeah, I look really good for my age. I'm pretty happy about it. What was the question?
Well, I'll give them a little bit of a taste of Hopeless. So you had a bunch of number ones. Sum 41 is involved. Mm-hmm. Yellow Card is involved. Who else?
So we have Sum 41, Taking Back Sundays on there. We've had All Time Low, had a number one a few years ago. Avenged Sevenfold is probably our most visible artist over the years.
Okay.
I mean, we had their first two records, Thrice. Going back, Mustard Plug had a pretty large career when ska was fantastically big. And, you know, now the big stuff being, Sum 41, Yellow Card, Taking Back Sunday, All Time Low, Bayside, we've had Silverstein, and then now coming up, Neck Deep, Moose Blood. And some guys from Australia called With Confidence, and a band from New York called Siler, all of our sort of newer bands that are hopefully going to grow into those spaces and many more. We have a lot of great artists.
Sure. So you're VP for... Biz Dev, right? Business development.
Yeah, I mean, because we're a small business, so our titles are kind of funny. We get them so that we can make our mothers proud. So my mother now doesn't think I live in a trailer and do drugs on the weekend.
Excellent.
She assumes that I have a real job now because I sent her an article that said executive vice president. So now that base is covered, I can quit. As my role is business development, it's also A&R. So I handle all of our signing and A&R strategy, and that includes once having the band, helping them find a manager or an agent, working on which producer they're going to be with, which writers, if they need that, performance, touring, you know, anytime I'm helping the agent submit for tours. But in addition to that, I oversee a lot of our business strategy, including our international business, our domestic sales. And we also have an investment portfolio as a small company. We have a couple buildings we own. We're invested in some other companies, and I do that consulting for them as well.
So you talked a little bit about kind of the evolution of not only your artists, but the business. And that's a big sense of what I got from researching Hopeless a little bit, was that you're constantly trying to move forward and change and chisel and evolve. Talk about that and how that plays into the daily operations of at Hopeless.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that, you know, we're still an independent company, so we don't have a major label ownership or a major partner involved. So as a small business, it's sort of a maybe some people think it's a curse, but it's a blessing. We can really turn the ship around pretty fast. And for us, we're a pretty tight-knit group in the office. We all think of each other as family. I mean, being at the label, sort of like I always say to the artists we're signing, it's like being in a band. You know, I toured with bands for a fair amount of time, and I think that the anxiety we face is similar to what an artist in an artist does or a band member does. And we have constant discussion of what's the right thing to do for the artist and for the business. That way we can stay afloat, you know. And I don't, you know, with Lewis, who owns a company, we've been incredibly successful in that space. We've always had, you know, 25 years of growth. And part of that is sitting down and deciding what are the artists we need to work with? Why are we working with those artists? What's the best, how can we work with the staff better to make this great for them? Because we want everyone to be a part of something great. You know, I mean, it's not just about sign bands and there's a star at the company and he's rising and the bands are getting thrown against the wall. Like, that's not our vibe. It's to sign things we believe in, work with people at the company that we want to work with, that we believe in those people too, so we can all have that sort of dream together. And we meet 4 times a year to talk about those changes and those strategies. And we do other fun outings. We went curling a few years ago.
Oh, which, love that.
I gotta say, I'm really terrible at it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Were you the sweeper?
I'm really bad at walking. Curling is, it's really not a great sport for me. For us, a lot of that change is predicated on really just us getting together and discussing, you know, how we can grow in the way we feel best or morally best with our artists. And I think that's been a driver for us, at least in the 12 years I've been there, and the company will be 25 at the end of the year.
Sure.
So
what's different than year one when you started? How do you handle bands differently now than you did almost a decade or over a decade ago?
You know, it's an interesting question. I think at the core of it, it hasn't changed. Okay. Because I think what I said before is that, you know, if anyone is a fan of the label or is going to look at it later, we fit in a certain demographic. I think that it's, you know, 17 to 25 is that core group of people, but we're pretty eclectic within that age range. For us, we're looking for artists that we believe have something to say, we believe are going to make an impact in whatever way that is, because I think some of our artists you could look at and say, I don't know what he's talking about. They make fart jokes. And I think that, yeah, that's from the outset, it's true, but they live it and breathe it, and the kids who show up to see that, like, that is an outlet for them to go somewhere, to have something in their life. And so that's what we're looking for when we're signing the band. So the way we're going to treat that is always, we want the bands to be as big as they can be. And that means listening to them and understanding how they see it going and then bringing our experience to that. Because record labels don't make fans, in our opinion. You know, we just kind of, whatever's happening for that artist, we put a magnifying glass over it and say, hey, we're going to bring this to our partners, we're going to bring this to our friends, and we're going to give you tools and investment to grow that. And so the staff is larger, the investments might be larger now, but the idea is still the same. Find artists that we believe in and that believe in us, and let's work together to have the best career we can, because some artists are going to get through one record and it's not going to work. You know, we want to be friends with them, and we still feel we believe in that record and want to put that out there. We've had bands sell 500 copies and it didn't go anywhere. And then some artists who've sold, you know, a million copies. And I think that the idea was the same for both artists. Some go 10, 20 years, some go a year and a half. And then we want to make sure that we're, hopefully the next incarnation is going to be even better, and we're going to stay friends. We've had that happen quite a few times. So
you can leave out the names of the bands, but any great stories from that?
From bands that failed? You want to hear that?
Well, that's just the pushing of the almost year and a half mark, and you're kind of not making it.
I mean, I'm sure there's people here who are in bands. Like, it starts, everyone's excited. You make a couple songs, like, this is the best thing ever. And then somebody like me also goes, this is the best thing ever. And we're all just jumping around and we sign it. And but there were personalities in the band that didn't work well. And they got on the road and they hated each other. And the main writer's like, you know what? I've got something better than this. And he's out and the band's done. Or there's other frustrating things like we're working and we feel like the music's great. We feel like the presentation's great. We're sending it to partners and they're saying, they give it a shot, but it doesn't work. And then it stalls. And like no one's picking it up. And we're trying to come up with ideas. Say, well, how can we generate a little activity? How can we generate, you know, excitement that gets people connected? And it just, for some whatever reason, luck, timing, it doesn't happen. And we have to sort of face that, you know, because a lot of times the artist might start blaming you. You're not spending enough money. And you say, I just don't know that if we just pile cash on this, it's going to make a difference. And that can be a frustrating conversation, but it needs to happen as soon as possible. Sort of like any relationship you have. If you're feeling lonely with your partner, I recommend don't spend 3 years being lonely with your partner. Say something soon.
Sure.
That's just general life advice. I think it works in the same respect. And we just have to say, hey, it isn't working. And I think we need to part ways so that you can figure out that next thing, whatever that is, whether it's another band or another project or regular life. But we go into that thinking it's going to be the biggest thing that it can be. And sometimes it just doesn't work. And I use the wrong word. It's not a failure. It's just the way it is. And we want to encourage, go do that next thing, because we'll all benefit if you do.
As you're talking, I'm kind of getting the sense that interpersonal skills and people skills seems to be a high priority for you. Talk about developing that through your career. You can talk a little bit about your previous very corporate days on the floor and where that has kind of accumulated for you as far as those skills and how that works for what you do now.
I think, well, for any time you're doing entertainment, I'm sure, and I saw a group of people come up. They were great presenters to start. I think that the idea of interacting and connecting with people is important because this is what this is about. On whatever level it is, sometimes it's very, the music has extreme anger and frustration, and that's still the communication. For me, I'm not always going to get every genre of music that we're working with as a personal fan, but I want to understand someone trying to create and someone trying to make a statement. And I think for me, I have to be able to try to understand where they're coming from and find common ground. And that takes, you know, time and patience. And like I was mentioning before, our system of A&R is I don't find the band and sign it and say, hey, team, work on this. It's a, hey, everyone, I found this band. I think they meet our morals and principles, and they like what we do. What do you think? And then we all have to kind of come together to understand that. That means I have to speak to everyone in our group and say, this is the reasons why I think we should do it. Do you agree with me? And so you're sort of negotiating with them, and they're negotiating back why they don't think that's there. And we shouldn't be in a space where we're arguing over stuff. We just want to have calm debate because this isn't life or death. It either makes sense for us or it doesn't. You know, and if it makes sense for us, we'll try to do our best job on it. For me, you know, not to go all the way back, but I think that when I toured for about 5 years doing live sound and tour management and merchandising and teching, whatever would keep me in a van for 11 months out of the year so I didn't have to live anywhere, which was a joy. I think that opportunity to be stuck in some scary places after hours where a man like me might get his ass completely handed to him was helpful in my negotiation skills. So that's how I've been able to keep this big nose without it looking over here. And I think it's important though because there's the people skills, because there's no real answers to this, right? You know, because sometimes you're feeling amazing about that work and no one's showing up. And we don't have that answer of why. We can only speculate based on experience. Like, we think that if you do this, it might generate excitement. And even then, it might not work. So the conversation has to be one, I do not know at all, but here's what might work for you. And if it doesn't work, we have to say, hey, we went in with all the best intentions that didn't. I'm happy to say that I was wrong. And I know for the future, I mean, this is, and I think that being able to have that discussion, it's important because you will get a call where someone will say, I got to the venue and the posters weren't there, you know, screw you for not doing the right thing. And it's like, well, why didn't we do that? And you can't just get into a defensive space like, well, screw you, you should be a better band.
Yeah.
That's not the right situation. You know, I know that's a micro issue, but the conversation is to be, well, what else do we think, what are we doing right now to make that happen? And let's double down on that versus worrying about this, which it's still a business, so there's a finite amount of money available, and everything costs, and the time costs too. I mean, everything is people's time on the road, our time in the office. So we have to make the best decision we know with the resources we have. And again, that's that people skill. You have to be able to discuss it and feel at least some mid-level comfort. You know, you have to come to an understanding.
Sure.
You know, because it's an emotional business.
Well, I love that dialogue piece. I think that that's super important in business, and that we don't get to talk about that enough. I love how much values alignment. I'm going to coin a term there. It's never been used before. we have a faculty member that loves to talk about aligning values, not only in your team, but in those that you work with regardless. And I think that's the successful business, and a 25-year winning streak proves that.
Yeah.
So speaking on those values, SubCity is a piece of the hopeless pie.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about what SubCity is and how it's grown
Absolutely.
In the past?
Yeah, so SubCity now is a 501c3 nonprofit. It's a pass-through profit. So we bring in funds and we pass them off to other charities. The owner of our company, Lewis, is an incredible man, and he was diagnosed with an illness where he lost his eyesight in the 90s. He was actually making films, and he lost his eyesight, and in that process was starting this business, and he's an incredibly inspirational human. And, you know, out of that idea of punk rock and giving back and sort of being active in the community on the ground, he had an idea to start SubCity, which was a way to connect bands, fans, with the passions and charities they believe in. And the idea was that a lot of times with charitable action, either you'll say, hey, do you like charity? And the person's like, yeah, I love it. What are you into? They say, oh, homelessness. Well, what have you done lately? Ah, I'm just so busy, I can't get to it. And I think that the idea was we wanted to do something that was easy for the band and the fan to be a part of it. So we said, if an artist signs to the label and there is a charity or a nonprofit that they're super passionate about, we'll make that phone call to that charity saying, hey, we have an artist and we're going to donate some funds to you. 5% of the wholesale price of everything they sell, streams, digital downloads, merchandise, will be donated to that nonprofit. We take half of that from the band's royalty and we match the other half out of our pocket. Some artists who are small can be $600, you know, to something as small as the Debbie Zuber Defense Foundation out in Denver. Or it can be like Thrice. We donated $250,000 to a place called Home, which is a teen runaway center in LA. For many years, we did Take Action Tour, which was a U.S. charity tour. We donated 10% of the tickets to that charity. And so through that idea, that all the kid had to do was buy his favorite band CD, and at that moment, he was giving back. He may or he or she did not know, but opened up, there's some literature. If 1% of the people who bought it said, wow, this is really interesting, that's a huge win. But just by the action of someone showing up, being a fan, being a part of the music, they were giving back to the community. And through that, we've raised $2.5 million for, I think, 72 charities through that. And it's great. Everybody who works at Hopeless works at the nonprofit. And our tagline, as you'll see, is make a positive impact. So not every artist has to do it. We'll have the same conversation. We do a lot of stuff without artists. You know, Lewis is involved in helping to build a studio and another teen center in the Valley.
Okay.
We look for opportunities to do that nonprofit work within our daily work, but in a way that it aligns, there's your word for you, with what we're already doing, so that no one has to have this stress about, oh man, I just don't have time to go down to the food bank and work. Like, the hope is that we can give back within our daily lives and it'll enrich somebody else's life. And that's part of the fabric of what we do. And that was started in 1999.
Okay.
So
is that something that you have started recruiting bands and you're kind of scouting out and they already know about? Is that something that they're...
Some do. It's many don't. You know, we always bring it up and I think that gets them thinking like, wow, this is the charity I would do. And
sure.
You know, it's not all or nothing either. We have some bands who are like, I just don't want to do it with the record, but we'll get them and say, well, hey, we have this exclusive photo. Can we just do a poster and it's $10 and all the proceeds go to this charity, you know. So we encourage our bands with every release. You know, in our marketing plan, there is a nonprofit make a positive impact section. And we'll say, does the artist have or want to do something in this? And they don't have to. There's not a judgment there. It's just if you can, we'd like to connect it. And it's something that we always look for. And we never want to make any artist feel like, well, if you don't do it, you really are a loser. No, it's just, hey, some people, they really love it. And some people are like, yeah, I like it, but I don't. I'm afraid if I do that, a fan may feel weird about it. And it's whatever their motivation is on it, it's not a problem. But it is our goal to always suggest it and make it a part of what we're doing, because that's, sure, if you're working at Hopeless, you're looking to make that impact wherever you can.
Sure. Yeah. I appreciate that sight beyond the immediate and giving back process. And that's something that I think is too easy to forget in the for-profit world, that it's easy to incorporate and align that just with the things you're naturally doing. So.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, I'm sure everybody here has been to a concert before. I was, a couple years ago, I was at one of our artists' shows, and I was looking, I was there early, and we were on stage chatting off the side stage, and there was a group of kids, maybe about 50 at the barricade, and the band wasn't going on for who knows how long. And as we were looking at that group of kids, and I thought to myself, wow, everyone looks just so happy right now, so happy. And when I looked at that crowd, I was kind of equating myself. I was like, high school kind of sucked in just some of the worst ways. And the way that I got through was no music, you know, and just having that community to speak about it. And we saw that in that moment, people were really excited to be there. There was no other problem in the world. It was just being present at that show. And I think that that excitement exists beyond the show. And for us with the nonprofit stuff, we're a part of entertainment because it means something to us. It defines who we are. It defines our friends. It defines how we speak. It defines the opinions we have in a lot of ways. And that excitement is a good way to have a conversation with someone about something bigger than themselves, because they want to be a part of that. Mostly, I'm generalizing. Yeah. Can't speak for everyone, but that looking at that, those faces and those eyes, it does mean someone or something to someone to be there at that event. And if they walk away with that feeling a little bit better, you know, so-and-so is making them feel like absolute garbage in another location, but right there they feel good, that person could be the next senator from this place or a great writer or a best friend that helps you through a good time because they have that great moment. And I think if we can capture that same experience in discussing positivity, you know, and it doesn't work all the time. And I think if there's 100,000 people and we can do that for two people, great. It doesn't have to be 100. It doesn't have to be 100%. Just has to be this much.
Yeah. So when you guys are looking at business strategies and you're mm-hmm. comparing markets, and you talked about how it's an age group, but it's mm-hmm. pretty diverse. Mm-hmm. Do you use psychographics for people who are more inclined to be charitable or in a position to be more charitable? Is that something that impacts the decisions you make with bands?
No, I don't. I mean, as far as choosing the artists that we're going to sign?
Choosing artists or even working to develop a career even further?
Not always. Like I said, we're looking for artists that I think are going to connect with fans. You know, they're going to connect, they're going to make an impact with that fan in the sort of general sense. Like, someone loves music, they see this like, wow, it's the best new thing. I've just discovered it. It's my favorite band. I mean, we're looking for that, really. Yeah. And again, when that artist comes in, we're going to offer them the option. And if they're interested, great. If they're coming to the table saying, we saw Sub City and this is something we're very interested in, I think that's a bonus, but it is not a prerequisite. You know, we're still looking for those artists that can really, really connect and be as big as we hope they can be. Sure. That doesn't always come with a charitable side. It's just, again, we're not forcing people into this position. That's not our goal. I don't want to force anybody in any position. Every opinion is valid. But if they want to be a part of it, then we'll help them. And, you know, when that's our goal, but I'm not imposing that on anybody else. And if there's a great artist that doesn't want to do it, no problem.
But you do maintain that your crowds are happier, more well-balanced human beings? Is that what you're saying?
Well-balanced is a stretch. I'm hoping that somehow we're helping people balance, but I assume that some of my artists are making people extremely unbalanced. But that's an okay thing. I'm not unbalanced people are typically the most creative.
That's true.
Balanced people I call when I have an insurance issue, typically.
Yes, yes. So a lot of our students are interested in exactly the career path you've had, mm-hmm. even though you were just describing it as kind of disjunct and not linear. That's hard to understand as a college student that it's never going to be linear. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about the road from 19 in the studio to now?
Yes, I can. Trying to think of the best way to do this without sounding like a derelict weirdo.
That's my motto, so they're used to that.
Oh, good, good. Yeah. Well, when I was in high school, I think it was mentioning, well, as you can see, I have this sweet boot today. It's a great look. Yeah, going snowboarding on this side only later. but it's going to be a great look. You know, I was disabled, and I think that it was tough to meet kids when I was younger, and just because I was in the hospital a lot, and then getting into high school, you know, I met some other kids that are into music, and, you know, I think I was studying trumpet as a kid, and there's not really a lot of great, cool band opportunities for a trumpet guy until ska was cool, and then I don't want to talk about that because it's not as cool as it was. But I started promoting shows when I was 15. You know, I just basement shows. And I thought it was really fun. I liked talking to people, and it was a great way to meet friends. And I would memorize bands and books. I couldn't even afford the records, and I would just have the conversation. And that really started me wanting to, I was really a part of that in my small hometown, just booking shows and going to shows. And that whole community was really, there was another guy doing a basement show in this town, another one doing in this town. Here you go, and you could really have this great community all over the county I was from. And from that, we had a four-track recorder, and I was like, I can record bands. And I could not record bands, but I had the buttons to press to make it look like I could record bands. Sure. And when I moved, you know, I got into a college in Albany, New York, and they had a recording program there. And I had some knowledge, so I started in that program early, even though I was majoring in business. This was my minor, and it was a great, there wasn't a lot of people in the program, and the director there was wonderful, a wonderful director. And she was like, yes, you can use this studio early. You know, you seem like you want to be a part of it. So, and they allowed overnight. So I would be in the studio by myself every night, and I would start inviting bands in to record. And again, still not very good at it, but it looked as though I was, because I had all this equipment in front of me. And through that, I just started meeting people locally. And I met this guy, Dave, and he had a band. And I said, hey, I could help you manage this band. And again, did not know what I was doing. And I think I told him, I was like, I don't know what I'm doing, but I used to cut his hair, so I think that's where he trusted me, because I could give him a good haircut, which makes good extra money if you're in college, by the way. It's safe and it's clean and no one will arrest you for it. You know, we started hanging and talking, and he would drive around his grandmother's car and play me all this music. I was like, I've never heard of these bands, and we got really excited. And through that process, I was working in a couple different studios and helping him with his band and going to his shows and just bumming around when I was in school. And then I got a job in Woodstock, New York, working for a live touring company. And we'd do live sound or live recording. The job was fun, but when I was on the road, it was great. When I was in the studio, I was either setting up mics or soldering the toaster back together, and which sounds very exciting. I couldn't believe I got the job. Wow, toasters and microwaves.
If you can't have a good strudel in a session,
what's
it worth?
I actually think that's what my boss said, and I kept thinking. And everybody there seemed to be in this weird space. They're in their late 40s, and there's like ponytails and bald spots and like my third wife. And man, you missed the good days with Slayer. And it was very depressing to be around.
Yeah.
I was like, you look gross, and I do not want to feel this or look this way in 10 years. I just don't. Actually, most of the people in the studio making me set up mics made me run for my life from that whole experience. I absolutely did not want to be in there, locked out of daylight, setting up microphones. And I knew that for a lot of people, like, that process got them to great places. I just didn't see it for me. And when Dave was like, hey, we're going on tour, let's book this big tour. And I said, you know, I got to get out of this town. And I sold all my stuff, and I went on tour with Dave, and I stayed on the road for 5 years working with his band and got jobs with other bands. And I started tour managing and just picked it up, and we meet other tour managers and ask them questions, and picked up lots of odd jobs designing merch and the whole thing. Mainly my goal wasn't to be a tour manager. My goal was to get out of this town, go and see the world, and not live anywhere. That was my goal.
Okay.
And so I achieved that goal very quickly. And then the way to keep that goal going was to work really hard at the other job. So the secondary, you know, became important. And when Dave moved to California, he said, do you want to go to California with me? And I said, no, I really think that state is terrible. But I will, but I love you, and I'll give it a shot. And I put a 6-month window on it because I thought for sure that I would do something terrible to someone or myself in that state. But it turned out it was okay. Maybe I've just become a shitty LA person. I have no idea. We'll find out soon. Look at this douche up here. Everyone's like, yes, yes, he is. He's terrible. You're the worst. I moved to California, and I got a job at Starbucks, you know, because I needed money. And Starbucks was the dopest job I've ever had. It was so easy. You show up 15 minutes early, memorize people's names, you get free food and coffee. And I was like, my God, I'm in heaven. It was Rice Krispie treats and coffee 24 hours a day and a stock investment plan. I was like, I'm in it. And my boss now offered, David was working for Equal Vision Records at the time, he offered him a job. He said, I can't take it. You should interview my roommate. And I did, and I took the job by total accident. And I thought, you know, this could be a cool run. Like, it was to, my first job was to be the in-house booking agent at Hopeless Records. And I don't think I'm a very good booking agent, and the bands we had to book then were pretty terrible. And so getting shows for them was a sad state of affairs. But I did it nonetheless, and it was a lot of fun, and I think I was really enjoying it. I knew so many bands. I was that annoying kid at the labels, like, Lewis, you got to check out this band. I could hear him on the phone, literally, oh, no, don't send me anything else. It's all terrible. And but I was persistent in not knowing that I was sending the worst stuff. And I just kept pushing it along. And then after a while, I was like, well, out of 100 bands, we should listen to one, because this poor kid, he's going to be very depressed if we don't listen to something soon. And through that process, went from being booking agent. The job for me was to actually get our band's agents. And so I got really good at that, and I got all the band's agents, and I had nothing to do. And my boss said, well, would you like to try sales? And I said, oh, sure, I'll give sales a try. I don't know what it is. I mean, I know what sales are, but I don't know music sales. And I got training on the domestic sales portion, which is iTunes, Best Buy, Target, a lot of record stores that don't exist anymore. And in the midst of that, he's like, you know, sales is worldwide. You need to do worldwide sales. And he said, you have to go to Medium. You have to go to Medium, and you need to handle our worldwide business. And I said, I don't know what Medium is. He said, well, I'll pay for you to go to France. I said, I'll go. And he handed me a stack of papers like this, said, all the information is in here. It was just a stack of receipts. And I was like, this looks terrible. I'm not going to look at this. I think it was a mistake not to look at the papers.
Hindsight, though.
Yeah. 2020. It is 2020. I should have looked closer.
Yeah.
And I booked this 4 days London and 5 days France and 6 days in Germany before cell phones. And I went nuts. I was booking meetings from 9 till midnight, and I immediately got sick. And my first day in France, I had 104 fever, and I was like, oh, man, if I don't do these meetings, I'm going to get fired. And so I did the meetings anyways, and was sneezing and coughing on people, and made it and did it, and it was a lot of fun. And out of that process of not dying, which is important to doing more things in your life, as I've heard, that's speculative at best, but I went on to do our international business, and through that we added team members in London, Milan, Toronto, Tokyo, Melbourne, Singapore, Rio, and Mexico City. I think I've said Mexico twice. It's an important country. So that's been a real joy. And you know, for us, like our international business is 38% of our total revenue now.
Okay.
And so out of that business, you know, it started, well, hey, we talked to these distributors, and I started doing our merchandise sales and put together our D2C business and our retail merchandise business. And then, you know, I kept bringing in bands and kept annoying people in my office with it. And sooner or later, I was the chief officer of annoyance. And so they said, you can have all of it. Just don't tell us about it until we need to. And that's how I grew into the, we didn't have an A&R specific role before that.
Sure.
It was a, you know, choose your own adventure, please don't piss us off sort of thing. And that's how that came to be. And I've been doing that A&R role since 2008 in a sort of the sense of that's been part of my role. And but I've touched a lot of the whole business in that process.
Yeah.
And career path wise, I don't own a home, and I do not have a two-car garage, and I wouldn't have enough cars to put in it if I had it. And I really think that whole process of owning that home sounds silly, and I live with six people at any given time, and I think that's great. And so I think when I was in high school, the guidance counselor was real big on telling me I needed to go to college, get that house, get a good job, you know, pay back my loans, have good credit. It sounded like a real scam to me. And I still think it is, but I have worked out the credit issues I had, which is pretty positive. And so, yeah, on that side, I think it's good to put it in there that I don't, I think doing this is a real joy. Like, it came accidentally, and I love working with the artists, and my job every day is I get to have a conversation about hopefully something that will make an impact for somebody in the world. And I'm not in a rush to have all the other stuff that I see on every article, magazine, whatever else I'm looking at. I'm just continuing to look and see the world and have a good time doing it. So that's how I got to here. And I'm sure that sounds super hippie, and I have no idea why I said that to you as strangers, but you take that and do what you want with it.
I disagree with the amount of happenstance that you're trying to position on your course of action, because it does sound like an intentional human being who has made these choices to continue those things that you found the most joy in, and that all of this is the subset of that. And these are just really causations after all of that, all of those choices and all of that intentional thinking.
I need you to write me a recommendation letter to my family.
I would happily do
helpful.
So.
Thank
yes.
you. Appreciate that. It'd be very nice for me.
But I love that, you know, choosing your path based on what you most align with. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you saying I was doing sales, I have a feeling that you were not so much selling to, but you were conversing with.
Yeah. I think that I mean, sales is interesting. If you're buying a used car, I expect the salesperson's going to suck.
Yeah.
And he's going to sell it to you. But I think for us, like, I think there's a, you know, and everybody can do it differently. And my, the way that I feel about sales, and it's still a sales job to sign bands and to get people, we're onboarding people all the time. I think the important part is that it's a long game. You know, I'm 37 now, and I think that...
Gasp, you're not 25, as you previously stated.
It's very surprising. Sad. Damn it. So I'm in this for a long time. I think the important part is we always say to like interns or people I work with is that don't call people and pitch them. If you're writing a letter to someone unsolicited and says, hello, my name is, and here is my band, and you... and you're not looking at it the right way. Like, there is a person you're writing to who could be insane. Wouldn't you like to know their insane story? Wouldn't you like to be a part of their insanity for a minute? Can I meet up with you and have an insane lunch? You know, that'd be pretty fun.
Yeah.
Someone hopefully is going to pay for that lunch down the line. It's going to be a great tax write-off. You get to have a po' boy and sit down and talk about insanity. And if that person likes you and you're on the same insane level, then you might be able to work together. But it ain't going to happen tomorrow. It might happen in 3 years. I think the important part is that you want to like people, hopefully, or you might want to hate them. Find someone you can hate together. Find lots of them. There are many of them. They're great. I think that the idea is that it's not about selling. It's about a community, a group of people that you can work with. And if you're helping each other out, because you may not be able to work with them today, but they may say, hey, I got this thing. You're like, interesting. Tomorrow someone says to you, you know, I'm looking for this thing. And you're like, light bulb, I'll put you two together. And then, wow, look at you just did a favor for two people, you know. I think that that's more important. You know, and the more people you meet with and talk with, they give you information. Now you're a head full of information. The next meeting you take, he's like, they're talking about, you know, I heard this thing. And you can get that by having a conversation with someone, not by saying, buy my stuff. It's the best stuff. You got to have this stuff. It's the best thing. Because I know about bands. There's people in it. They're playing music. They have instruments. They stand. They have pictures. The whole thing is pretty normal. I've seen it 1,000 times. You know, all you have to do is just, you know, that's what it is. But why? And no one wants the band. They want to know why, and they want to feel they trust you in that way. And so you have to build that, and it doesn't happen in a year. Well, for some people it does, and they own really nice cars. But I think the long game is that you want people to be your friend, and you want to bring them things that enrich their life, and hopefully they do the same for you. And along the way, you build a close group, and hopefully a nice group around it. And you're gonna always be trading that information and having that personal relationship. So when you have something great, or you believe you have something great, you can go and say, listen, I believe I have something here and I want to send it to you. And like, please do. And they call you around and say, wow, I see what you're going after. I don't get it, but I like what you're doing here. Call me back in a couple months. But hey, at least they return the phone call like that.
Yeah.
So, and I think in the sales side, it's not sales like I'm selling something. We're just having a relationship and hoping that we're believing each other that we're going to work on something great and we're going to be a part of something great and we're going to share that with each other.
Okay. So, we've kind of walked through the steps of some of our students that they're pursuing the businessy business part of the music industry. Mm-hmm. We also have students that are performing as regular acts, and that's what mm-hmm. they want to make their career as. So give me a hypothetical. Walk me through your team heading mm-hmm. to a show. What are you looking for? What's the thing that sparks your excitement about working with a group of people or a solo act?
This is the, I guess now, billion-dollar question that's marked for inflation. told you it's me, shitty dad jokes all day. You know, it's interesting because it's sometimes we'll hear music in the office because we don't always get the luxury of seeing it live every time sure. because, you know, we're in L.A. and I can't fly all over the world. And we'll see a video, we'll see a song like, wow, this whole project is amazing. It's got the vibe. And then we call the artist and we want to feel out like, are they just saying, we're going to work really hard? Or are they going to sound like, this is my whole life. I've been born to do this. And like, wow, this person has that level of unbalanced artistry that is great, you know? And, but it always depends. If I go to the show, I mean, it doesn't often have to be the best live performance, but it has to make me feel something, you know? And I always say to any band, like, would you buy you? If you saw a video of yourself, and if you haven't seen a video of yourself performing, you're making a huge mistake. It's good to laugh at yourself. If you wouldn't buy you, why should I? You know, what are you saying up there? What are you putting out in the world? Again, I think it's important to say, like, by merit of me standing on a stage with a guitar, I'm not a musician. I'll be the first to tell you that I'm not a musician. But if I stand on the stage with a guitar and strum it, I am a musician. Do I deserve to be signed?
Sure.
I don't know. You know, I mean, I think that what is beyond the music is important, because I think you can be an incredible musician. You can be an incredible arranger. You know, you can do all the things, but if you're not a showman, you know, or showwoman or showperson, there's nothing for us to grab onto, because a lot of times, you know, we're mixing art and commerce. It's a dangerous thing. You know, I mean, if it's art and straight art, sometimes it's better that it's not sold. But when it needs to be sold, there's got to be a story there. We have to, you know, press doesn't pick up music sometimes just because it's great. Sometimes they do, but they want to know what else. We had a great review. What else? You know, what's the story behind it? And so for me, it's not just the performance. It's what's their social media look? What's the vibe on their designs for merchandise? What's the logo look like? How do they speak? What does their Twitter look like? Who are they friends with? You know, there's very a lot of multiples. And it doesn't have to check every box, but it has to give me the feeling like this can grow into something great. And we're in a very specific genre, you know, young lifestyle rock. So what works for me is different for a different label. You know, in my specific, that sort of idea that someone is speaking to a group of people and connecting, both to the bands and to the fans, is super important. And sometimes the songs can be, people might say, those are generic. It doesn't have to be amazing the first time, but the idea has to be good, and we can work into better songs. We can have conversations about where do we think creatively this should go? What do you want to say? What is that artist statement? You know, where would you like to see this be in 5 years? And then we can start to build that out. So it's hard, because one band I'll see and I'll just be so excited, I don't even know why. It just feels like it's going to be great. And other bands, it's a little more technical, like, well, what are their streaming numbers? It seems like people are interested, and let's work on it. And I think they're all valid, and there's not a huge science to it for us. You know, I mean, we have analytics we look at, but that doesn't steer the decision every time. You know, most of the times it doesn't at all.
You're giving me the impression that the industry is starting to have a heart, and I love that impression.
Yeah.
I appreciate the fact that there's a team out there considering just the gut reaction to an experience. So that's an excellent, that's a very positive move forward. So let me ask you your opinion. You said lifestyle. What was the actual term that you used? Lifestyle rock?
I think we always were lifestyle brand, but lifestyle, alternative lifestyle.
Okay.
Rock is what we kind of think, I guess. That's a pretty bad way to put it. We should come up with a better phrase for this conversation so I don't seem like such a fool when I say it out loud.
We'll get a hashtag going. It'll be
I think just thank you. The word lifestyle is that, I mean, the people who are at least part of what, you know, the music we're working on, it's very meaningful to them. A lot of them, they're fans of all the bands in it.
Okay.
Because that's just, they're going to all those shows, the local shows, the touring shows. In that sense, we're selling to a greater conversation than just a, hey, we're going to work on a single and we're going to go radio and the single will be big. And when the single's not good anymore, the band's done and see ya and try something next. We're doing something different. I have bands that will never sell more than 1,000, 1,500 records, but they're very meaningful in our community, and that's something important to us. Obviously, can't give them the same budget someone's going to sell 100,000 records, but I think we're going to work with them because hopefully the reason they're with us is because we had a conversation that was, you're very important. We want to be a part of that process because you bring credibility this way and we bring it that way.
Sure.
So with lifestyle in that way, that was always the challenge for us in the early days, is that I'd go to like a Best Buy and there'd be a guy in his khakis with his blue shirt tucked in sitting there, and he really loves Van Halen and he's pretty sure how that works. And I'm like, well, this is rock. And he goes like, Van Halen? And I'm like, yeah, that's exactly it, man. Good times. And, you know, it's not a radio plan. Most of our bands isn't, okay, we got this hot single and we've tested it in these markets and let's get 1,000 records. Hey, our social media is like this and kids are showing up and everyone's wearing the t-shirt and there's a building vibe from the bottom. You know, we have an artist called All Time Low, and, you know, and that band, we just hit 1 million sold on their single, Dear Maria, and the band's never had radio.
Yeah.
That's just people being a part of it. You know, it's never touched radio. You know, I mean, it's different in the UK. They're a big radio star, but here they never were. And I mean, that band does 5,000-6,000 tickets a night. You know, and that the kids who show up, it's a huge thing for them. It's a giant thing. And it's always been about that life, that thing, that like, wow, these cute boys and their jokes and they're a little dirty and mom says no. And here we are and we wear the t-shirts and part of the videos. And it's like, and it works. I'm not part of it. I mean, I'm there sometimes, and I look like a creep, but, I mean, I'm, you know, it worked, and it doesn't need. So having that conversation is over time training people, like, you can't look at what we do like you would maybe like a Capital Cities, you know, who's an alternative band who had a radio single and they backed touring into it. There's nothing wrong with that. That's a fine way to develop artists. It's just not the way that our genre does it. Like, we're based a lot of on making that statement over time and doing content to create a look and a feel that connects with people in a sort of long term. That's why our direct-to-consumer business, our merch business, is typically larger in our genre because of people wanting to wear and be a part of that, you know, self-identify with that. So, yeah.
I hear that from a former guitar tech colleague that I had, that mic tricks also, you know, lasso.
Swinging mic tricks are great.
Yeah, that's a big part of
lawsuits.
That lifestyle. Oh, okay. Yeah. Excellent.
But yes. Yes, we do have a band that is synonymous with mic tricks, and he's very good at it. And he will say from stage, if you're not paying attention to him, I can take your eye out with this mic. You just remember that. And I always feel a little uncomfortable with it, but it is kind of funny when he says it. I always wish he would do it.
He's stealing my teaching techniques, by the way.
I'm very imbalanced.
So I'll have to sue him for that. But.
Yeah, okay. All right. Yeah, no, I mean, listen, that was part of, I mean, the artist we're speaking of, you didn't know, is Taking Back Sunday, and I think a big part of their growth in the community was that stage show. I mean, if, you know, I think for Taking Back Sunday, it was about the sort of rawness they brought to their show. Even when they were small, I mean, I saw them in rooms that were 100 cap, and you could just feel it. I think a good example is a band now that's doing wonderful, 21 Pilots. And when I went and saw them play for 200 people in Cleveland, your hair was blown back by how intense that performance was. You could really feel something great was happening. And they had riding the crowd with drums and everything else. And they were doing that when it was a few people in the room. Like, it was true at the time it started, and it was real. It came from a real creative place.
Yeah.
It wasn't a hobby.
Yeah.
It was a reality that they needed to perform and put out there what they had to say. And that's the same way that's been for Taking Back Sunday in that way. So the mic tricks are just part and parcel to that. I mean, I know you have to go home and stand in your room and swing it around for a while.
A lot of practice.
You'd have to ask Adam how that goes. I don't know what he does alone in his room with his mic, you know. So.
Yikes. I think that's a great place to open up the floor for questions.
Yeah.
All right, can we get the lights on so we can do some questions? Oh, no.
You all look so beautiful, I knew it. I really want to cross my legs, but this will hurt.
Questions. We have a question over here.
Hello.
Hi, how are you?
I'm medium. Yeah.
I have two questions, okay?
That's absolutely fine.
Okay, my first question was when she was asking about, like, your role to where you are today, and I know it kind of, for you maybe, was like, it felt like it just kind of all fell into place for you.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, for, like, people, you know, who are trying to pursue that
it's not just my weird attempt to, like, not do anything with my life and accidentally do it. Yeah, I know what you're saying. I think if you're asking something specific, I mean, well, first of all, you know, ask questions as much as you can. And I don't mean that in the vague way that your guidance counselor would give you that information. Like, do internships, listen, ask questions, be a part of the conversation when it's appropriate. And then when I first started at the label, I didn't really know anybody, so I made a long list of all the bands that I loved and went and looked at all their managers and all their agents and made a big Excel grid of it. And then I went and figured out their email addresses and emailed everybody, knowing that 95% of them would delete it. But a few people took my meeting, and I sat with them and I said, I'm a noob and I know nothing, but I'm real excited. And I said, and you are smart, I think. And so share with me the information you have. And they did. And it was, you know, it wasn't big information, but it was like a little crumb they gave me. And the next meeting, I took that crumb and said, you know, I just met with so-and-so, validating that I had a meeting with someone. And they gave me X crumb, and which is a cool crumb. And what do you think about that? And I sort of became a gossip queen. But, you know, with the reality of it, like, specifically, I needed to know people. And I wanted to feel like, and I was very straight with people, that I didn't know what I was doing, but I wanted their information. And a lot of people, old people like myself, like to be asked, like, you're real great. Why don't you tell me something? And I'm like, damn, I am great. I would love to tell you something. Don't be surprised. People love it. If you're specifically looking for that, take the meetings you can, you know, and be a part of the conversation that they want to hear sometimes. Because remember, we're talking about sales. Like, you're taking information from people and you're turning it into your information and you're giving it back out because you want to be part of this. This is so exciting. You want to know everything. And the more you know and the more you're having conversations, at the same time, you're bringing information to meetings as well, hopefully, and people are excited. At this stage, take a job and have the goal to be the best at the job you can, even if the only gig you can get is setting up microphones. Be real good at it and ask lots of questions and be the best person, because there's all those jaded ass, shit, jaded people in the office that make clients feel like shit. But you don't have to do that. You can be the best person in the room because you've got the time for it right now. You can be jaded when you want to be jaded. But for now, specifically, if you want to be, you're going to have to go make that list of all the things you want to do, and you're just going to have to put it out there. And you're going to find out, you're not asking, can I get an internship? You're asking, you know, I'd love to, I'm in school and I'd love to just meet up and hear what you're doing, you know? And I think that's the best advice. I think if you can do it on your own, so if you're interested in PR, for example, well, find a local band and go do PR. Sure, the band might not be great and you may not get anyone on the phone, but it's not about the results, it's about the process. And then if you look on your resume and say, ran my own PR company, I think that's a great way to do it. Those are a couple ways. That's the way that I would suggest to do it. You know, internships are amazing. You know, I mean, there's so many of them. And if you can save up the cash and go to Nashville or New York or LA and just go intern for a summer, get two, get three interns if you can do it, and then work the morning shift at a coffee shop. Do it because you got the energy to stay awake, and damn, that's a good story. Go get as many as you can. That's how I would say to specifically do it. I don't know if that answers your question.
This is a good time for me to ask, does Hopeless or Sub City, do you guys support internships?
We do. We support free labor. Yeah. It's California.
Excellent.
We're seceding soon, so it's totally cool.
Can't wait.
Yeah.
And my other question.
Yeah.
When you guys are, you know, looking for artists around in your family and things like that, are you guys, like, specifically looking for artists? Do you have some time you're looking for them, or do they just come across your desk? And what is your advice for artists to make themselves more appealing to the design? And
we're looking for artists every day of the year, all hours of the day, I suppose. If someone sends it to me and it's exciting, I'm interested in it. How to be exciting? You're a fan of music. That's a question really for yourself. If there's something you love, like, I don't know what you like. Let's just say that you really love Aerosmith. I don't know if you love Aerosmith, but you might like Aerosmith. And so you're spending a lot of time like, man, that's Steven Tyler. He's fucking weird. He's crazy, and I love it. Why are you so attracted to Steven Tyler in that way? Like, why is it so exciting to you? You need to be that. Be your favorite artist. Because if you look at yourself in a video and you're like, I wouldn't buy this, then maybe it's not so exciting. That's it.
Simple as that.
I don't know, that's how I would put it. I know it's like wrapping a lot of shit in like this tiny little ball, but cool.
All right, finally next question. Miss Ella.
Hi.
Hello.
Being an artist who has absolutely no connection to someone like you who is looking for artists,
lucky,
probably like me, how do I get a hold of someone like you, or specifically you, to like...
Well, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to go down a list of technologies. I'm going to start with an old one, the phone. Two, email, Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter, Instagram.
Where is that information, though? Like, yours, like, let's say...
Oh, don't worry, I'm in need of attention like everyone else. I have social media.
Let's say I had a...
I might ignore you, yeah. But... Well, I mean, since we're here today and you're accosting me with your questions, I would love to give you my email.
Okay.
How about that?
I'll take it.
So the first thing you do is ask, and then I gave it to you. I'm going to give it now. You can come get me after.
I will.
Make everyone else work for it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Tristan.
Okay, this is kind of a general question, but you live in LA now. Do you think that there's a
Sadly,
certain
yes.
good, like... Do you think there's like a certain good like city or like certain cities that are better? I mean, there's Nashville, New York, LA, but are there different ones?
Do you know what you want to do in entertainment?
I would love to be a performer, and that's my main goal.
That's good to hear. Let me give you some options on this. Rio, Vegas, New York, Las Vegas. I think I said
that's
that twice.
Where I'm from.
Yeah, so you can go back to life. If you want to be a performer, it depends on what you want to be. I mean, Vegas, if you want to make contract money and you want to perform and you want options, God, I can't think of a better place than Vegas. I know it sounds weird. If you're looking to, if it's more about like big TV or like getting into be a pop star or something like this, then LA might be a good spot. If it's country, Nashville, you know. But if it's going to be, it just depends. But like this, the standard ones are New York, LA, and Nashville. Nashville's going to be the one country, though a lot of people are leaving New York to Nashville, so it's becoming a little more eclectic. It's not just country, though it's predominantly in that space, Christian country music. LA, when it comes to like pop writers and producers, there's a lot of them there. There's a fair amount of, most of the major labels have offices in LA and New York, so you can do LA or New York. LA is a lot cheaper. If it's performance and it's just about being a great singer, a great player, or a accompanist or arranger, I mean, you could be in LA and do the Vegas racket if you wanted to. I know a lot of people have made money as performers. You hate to hear this, but like cruise lines, you can make a ton of money
being a performance. When you're young and you can do that, it's not a bad resume builder to do that as well. I don't know your specific needs, but I don't deal with a lot of those ones, but those are some of the places you could go. If you're already from Vegas and you can drive the 5 hours to LA, try LA out. You appear to me to be quite young, so I would assume you could get 5 cities under your belt before you're my age. So give it a shot. No problem.
All right, we have time for one more question.
Hi.
So you said that like at a young age you kind of sold everything and moved on tour. I just wanted to know like if you had any fear about that, and if so, like how did you overcome that?
God, I was fucking scared out of my brain. One, for being disabled and having no health insurance, sure. I've learned a lot about self-surgery. I don't recommend it. And yeah, of course. Why not? But I think that, I think that there's a sort of safety in like, I've got my apartment, I've got my job, and I pay my rent, and I can't miss a rent payment. And it's not a bad thing to do. I think a lot of people do it. I think it works just fine. You know, I think that living in that space there's a real like setting for that. You know how to do it.
Anytime you're going to do something completely different, sure, it's going to cause you some anxiety. But you find out that, as we hear now, normalization is pretty easy. You know, when you get into a place that's different, you know, you just have to always like take a step back. You don't have to be a bull in a china shop. Wait to see how it goes. Figure out your surroundings and you'll get used to it. You know, people get used to stuff all the time. Much, much worse than that. You know, so I think if you want to do it and your intention is to go have that change in your life, you will face it. You'll have anxiety because that's a good thing to have. You'll pack some things you think you might need and later on realize you probably don't need it. But it's more about just taking that plunge, I think. I was very nervous about it. Like leaving, I had that job at the studio, I had the apartment, I had a lease, I had to break that lease. I was worried, is this guy going to sue me? I don't know, I'm a kid, you know? And ultimately it was worth it. It was worth it because it met another goal that I wanted, you know? So I can't, again, I don't know your specific situation, but anytime you're going to do something different, like going to school, I'm sure was nerve-wracking. It's no different than that. Getting a new job is nerve-wracking. It's the same rules apply. Try to figure out your bearings, and you'll settle into it. No problem.
All right, guys. This was a good forum. Thank you, Eric Tobin. Happy Mardi Gras. Be safe.